kind of quick overview, we'll start with an introduction, essential question, and then I'm going to go into like migration, that's one main thing, and then weather, conservation, and wrap it up with recruiting. Migration, weather, conservation, three most important factors in, like affecting waterfowl, and weather affects it by like rain, snow, temperature difference, you know, wind direction and speed, migrations, you know, they come down out of Canada and stay for a little while and then move south depending on weather, and sometimes if it gets too cold, that's what pushes them from Canada, and it's warmer down here, and then when it gets cold here, it moves them down. When the lakes and ponds and rivers start to freeze up, the essential question is, how does migration, weather, and conservation affect the waterfowl population? Regulation for waterfowl. And there's a lot of rules and regulations that I'll get into in a little bit about what you need to do. So, whenever I personally think of the word migration, I always think of like a geese flying, and a bee coming down, going to fall in the springtime, and coming back up from southern places, finding their area of where they need to breed. And as this map shows, it shows the different main flyways in America and North America. So the Pacific is, you know, in purple. That comes over, you know, not too far, but that, and it goes down into western Mexico and all the way up to Alaska, the western parts of Canada. Central, that's where like Kansas, Nebraska, and all those states really are. And they get a lot of birds coming through there. Not quite as many as like the Mississippi Flyway. It covers more states and doesn't. It looks like it's a smaller ground because it doesn't cover, you know, in Canada and down in Mexico and stuff. But it holds way more birds than any other flyway does. The Pacific is where we are. Comes up into Canada, gets the eastern half, goes all the way down to Florida. So it doesn't have as many birds. This is a graph of what I pulled off of Blue Ducks on the Mid website. Sources at the end. It shows the number of waterfowls who hunt that area, the number of ducks harvested, number of geese harvested. And as you can see, the Mississippi Flyway holds the most hunters, and it holds the most numbers and birds that have been harvested over the year.
Question? No, I was just wondering, because you've got the four different ones, do they all tend to fly north in equal patterns, or is there one flyway that starts earlier, or?
It all connects to like the weather and where it's going to be, and where the storms are going to be coming through. This was the 1920 season statistics. Well, like I said earlier, the weather and stuff, it's snow, rain, that'll push them, it'll keep them lower. And being a hunter, I've noticed like when it's sunny, they're going to stay up higher in the sky than when it's rainy, cloudy, snowy. They're going to be lower during that. They're not going to want to fly high, and they're not going to want to stay in that. And they definitely won't fly as far and as long as when it's sunny. about, these are three different birds that have been brought in by weather, and when you get storms that come up the Gulf and the coast, they bring in some very weird birds that we don't, that aren't normal for around here. And those are two grant, which are like a small goose. Classified goose or not, but for the cost. And that picture was taken on my father's lawn years ago. And it was just, they stuck around for a day or two and then they were gone. The center picture is a picture of an American widgeon that I took this spring over here on the Black River Road. I was just looking around, seeing what there was, because someone was hunting, and there was a pair of American widgeon. Those birds are not native from here, neither breeding or just their time. And the picture on the right is a pintail that Brandon shot a few years ago. And those birds are definitely not from around here. They normally get shot most in the Central Florida and Mississippi, Florida. And as you can tell, it's not, you know, the prettiest bird, but if it's a hen. But normally a drake will have a brown head and a whiter body, and the tail will be longer, which is called a sprig. And it's a really pretty bird, but, and it's nice that we were able to shoot one of those. So the different weather and brought weird birds in. Okay, well, the kind of thing is conservation. Well, banding. This will pass around some things here. We'll talk about it. The bands are important because they'll put bands on a goose, like their leg, but right here. And they use them to track them. And once you harvest, if you harvest a bird, well, they'll put it on ducks and geese too. And once you harvest a bird with a band, you have to report it. And once you call it in, call in the numbers. On those, there's silver band on them. And on Brandon's, there's a neck band on it. On that picture, we got lucky enough and shot two geese with bands. Kind of hard to tell in the picture, but that's the orange band that's on the lanyard now. And then another one that's on there too to track it. And then I add one to another one. And they call in the numbers, they'll give you the information on those certificates. It has the number, it has the sex of the bird, it has when it was hatched, and like when it was banded. So on some of them it says like it was too young to fly when hatched and or when banded in whatever year it was. The most recent one was my band, which is on Mr. Smith's flat lanyard, and that's actually false. Jeremiah's band is a recent one. It's not on either of them because I didn't get his lanyard, which is in that picture, and he's holding that bird. One that's on mine is the one I'm holding there, and Brandon, those two are on his lanyard. He also, I shot two before. I was with him for one of them, and the other one we got in Addison County. I don't think it was on the house for some of the bird buddies. Refuges. So, speaking of Brandon going to Addison County, there's refuges there right next to where he was hunting. And I think it was back in 2015, 2016. When we all sent in applications to go to refuges, my father, Brandon, and I, and pretty sure my grandfather did too. and all three of us got accepted to go, you could each bring, two other guys, okay, to sit in your blind with you. And so we all ended up going. Me and my father got, like, accepted into Dead Creek, which is field hunting. You got a bunch of snow geese coming over, you have Canada's coming over. And it's the same limitation, but you're only allowed to shoot one box of shotgun shells per person. You only get 25 shells per person. And they have, like, pre-made blinds for you in the field, which, in my opinion, wasn't the greatest experience because the birds are used to the tall blinds and other people hunting out of them, so they kind of just avoid them. But and there's only a certain amount of people that are allowed to hunt, but that get, like, accepted to hunt there. And we got lucky enough to do it. We didn't end up killing any of them, but Brandon went there a few years before, not to the place, but one of his buddies owned another bit of property next to it, or, like, down the road, and that's where he got his first band. And Mud Creek, Brandon got accepted for that. He brought, Richard brought Graham and somebody else. And they went out, they didn't get anything. But that is, like, Dead Creek was field hunting, and Mud Creek is sort of water hunting, but mud hunting, as you can tell by the name of it. Having a canoe and paddle through mud, you get out where you want, and there's more guys there shooting, and they're in a more closer area. But, so that was good. We got to go out and do that. There's refuges all over the place. That's where most of the banding happens. They'll have a net or, like, a trap to where they'll get the birds. It won't harm them or anything, and they'll come back. They'll grab them out of the trap, put the band on it, punch the information in to the website, and then they'll release the bird on them. There's other versions of banding. There's the leg bands, like, on the lanyards. There's the neck band, which is also on the lanyards. And then there's also toe tags, which will get put on. If you've ever seen a goose before, there's the webbing here. It'll get put in the webbing, with just like a little ring in the webbing. And you can punch that information in as well to the website. It'll also, most of the time when a bird gets toe tagged, they'll put a normal leg band on it too, so that it's easier to read the information. And there's also another kind, which is GPS tracking, which are very rare. These are very rare as well, but GPS trackers, never even, like, seen one. But put it on the back of the goose or a duck, and they'll GPS track it and, like keep track of it exactly where it's going at all times, and they'll call that in. Not many people are able to get one of those. They also have leg bands, but they're reward bands. So they'll be different colors and the different prices, or different rewards. You call it in and they'll send you anywhere between like $40 and $400 for the bird that you shot, which honestly is okay. I mean, it kind of puts a price on the bird itself, so it's not the greatest, but it would definitely be, you definitely are lucky if you get one of those, no matter what your stand is on it. Another conservation thing is predation. There's a lot of predators out there, especially for waterfowl. I mean, like, coyotes, even a largemouth bass will eat ducklings or whatever. If it's swimming around and it's small enough, bass or fish will eat it. hawks, crows will eat a bird. It might not kill too many of them, most of a lot of them, but yeah, raccoons will raid nests, skunks will raid nests, possums will raid nests. Turtles, we've seen plenty of birds when we're hunting, will come in and they'll only have 1 foot. Well, you just wonder what happened to it, but a turtle will come up and bite the foot off of the duck if it can, and they'll eat the duck if they can. Then there's a rise in predators all over the place. I mean, there's so many people that, well, back in the day, they used to hunt, you know, coyotes and everything so often, but now it's been going down crazy. And trapping, we used to do a lot of that, but we'd go and we'd go to help out with conservation, but we'd also go and you can get money for the pellets and stuff to then put back into getting, you know, your traps, your lures, whatever you need. But that also, we've been cutting out of that, and there's been so many trappers that just can't do it anymore because the price on fur is going down. You're not profiting at all. You're not even, half the time you're not even making back, you know, what you put into it. So it's not really all that worth it. Especially if you can't afford to do all that, you just have to lose whatever you have. That's why, you know, predation's a big thing. Hopefully we can get more people to help out with that. It's the rules and regulations for Vermont Fish and Wildlife. You got restrictions, as normal. You know, no person shall take game birds with like a trap, snare, and that. You can't just go out fishing and get a duck or goose. That's not part of the experience. You can't shoot a shotgun that's more than a 10 gauge. It's definitely not necessary to even use a 10 gauge when you're duck hunting. Goose hunting, maybe sometimes, but it's not really that necessary. I have a 20 gauge and a 12 gauge, and the 20 gauge outperforms the 12 gauge any day. So, a punt gun, battery gun, machine gun, kind of, you know, you can probably tell why you shouldn't be using those. Fish hook, explosives, drugs, a shotgun that's capable of holding more than 3 shells. That's a big thing when you're hunting. Well, especially now with the limits going down, right, you don't want to overshoot your limit. If you overshoot your limit, you can get in a lot of trouble for it. You can lose your license for a long time. Right, you don't want to have more shells in your gun than you need. You don't want to shoot more birds than you need. So they have a plug that goes in the tip of the gun. I didn't include it in my slideshow because I didn't know if I was going to be able to put pictures of guns in the slideshow for school. But if you've ever seen a gun before, or a shotgun, to be exact, there's the barrel, and then there's under the barrel where you hold it, and that can unscrew on a pump and semi-auto shotgun, and you can take a plug out or put a plug in. Plug makes it, if you don't have a plug in your gun, you can put five to seven shells in your gun. But with the plug, it limits you to only hold 2 shells. Yeah, one in the chamber and eventually the two. Which, you know, it makes a big difference because if you're shooting into a big group of birds and your limit is 3 birds or 2 birds, you don't want to shoot over that. And if you have 5 shells in your gun, you might think about it, but in the moment, you're not gonna think about it. You're just gonna keep shooting. So, So, shooting hours, it's later, well, a couple pages down, it'll show the table for shooting hours, but no person shall take migratory game birds, you know, except during shooting hours. So that's like, that's a half an hour before sunrise, and it's a half an hour after sunset. So it gives birds enough time at night to where they can go from their field to their roost, which is most likely a pond or a lake, sometimes a manure pit, sometimes a river if the ponds and lakes are frozen. It gives them enough time to get there without being pressured for the night so that they can calm down and we can go back out in the morning. Daily bag limit, no person shall take any more birds, you know, than your limit, which I also said later in a couple pages what your limit is. Your possession limit, that's three times what your daily limit is. That's like what you can have on you. Doesn't mean you can shoot over your limit and think that that's your possession limit because you will get caught for it. I'll move on to the next page. It talks about youth water fowl hunting days. It's 17 years younger, you can go out. You can take somebody out at 18. But there's different spots in Vermont where you can go. Like, there's the Connecticut River zone that runs down the coast there. There's the Lake Champlain zone that runs down the other coast. And then there's the interior Vermont zone. In this, you're supposed to be 15 years of age or younger to participate in the Connecticut River zone. So you got to really watch your rules and regulations if you're going to be going out. You can hunt the same things the week weekend as you can normal season. Sometimes the season will overlap. Youth weekend will be on the last weekend of early goose season. So, does that mean that you can go youth hunting or go goose hunting and then go youth hunting afterwards? I don't know, it doesn't say in regulation. But you definitely can't overshoot what you're going to be doing. Where it shows, so this shows the hunting zones, the Connecticut River zones all the way over here on the right, it runs all the way down, and you can do your spot right here, Lake Champlain zone runs that, and then the interior Vermont zone basically takes up all of Vermont besides those areas. Those are the daily shooting time hours, you can go on there instead of like checking your phone or whatever. And the big thing here is you should stand time where it changes in November because that makes a big difference because you're going to get used to, you know, hunting 7 o'clock, 7:03, 7:04, and then it's just automatically it's going to change the next day to 6, and if you set your alarm for 6:30 because you're ready to go hunting at 7, you're going to be late. And then the last important page Alright. So this shows your, you know, seasons the last year, and it also is different in each zone. Last year in our zone, it was the 13th of October to December 11th. Do I think the season should have been longer? Yeah, because December 11th, the birds weren't all here from Canada yet. Canada goose seasons, they have a split season. They have a split season every year. They've got an early season, which runs from September 1st to September 25th, which is normally only when it ends is the weekend of youth weekend, like I said before. And then they start it up again the first day of duck season. You can on ducks and geese in that, and then it goes for like a month before it actually nets. I don't personally own any of the rest of them, so we don't really get brant like I said earlier, and I don't really hunt off of the duck and snipe. But I'll scroll down here, it'll say what the limits are per duck. Per species of duck. So the ducks, they limit 6, but you cannot shoot more than 2 mallards a day, which those are what mallards look like. The brown one is a hen, which you can only shoot 1 of per day. And the green head is what we call them, the drakes, the male. You can shoot 2 of those, or 1 of those, and 1 hen. You can only shoot 1 hen a day, though. Two black ducks, I don't have an example of those, but they look like the hen, they're just darker. Kind of in the name. 3 wood ducks are a really, really pretty duck. And those are mostly what we shoot in the early season, like the first month of the season. And then things like 1 pintail, 2 canvasbacks, 2 redheads. We don't really get those very often. 2 or 1 scop. We had a split in scop this year to where one season you could shoot 2, but then the next split you can only shoot 1. We really got to watch that. So I'll go back. Well, let me wrap it up. Thanks to Jeremiah. Thanks to Brandon for helping me out and letting me use your resources. Savannah's not here, but I thank her for helping me out a little bit. And yeah, thank y'all for being here. Giving me the time to go.